But yesterday, former President John Dramani Mahama, you know, launched his fundraising campaign for his election. But before that, there were a lot of conversations about funding of, you know, political parties and campaigns. And the former president talked about, you know, what he believes should be done. First, we'll listen to the former president. And we'll also get to hear from Yao Domelevo, Daniel Yao Domelevo, who is a former auditor general. He spoke to Raymond on Upfront last night. And then finally, you would hear from Elvis Efriankra on the underpinnings of corruption being campaign financing.
On government support for funding political parties, some have argued that the only funding that may be advanced to parties and cannot be concealed in secrecy is public funding of these parties. This refers to government giving financial resources or indirect assistance to political parties. As mentioned, in the absence of such support and which costs of political activities, wealthy party financiers take over as political godfathers who determine electoral outcomes and all that follows it. And as I stated earlier, because of our current economic crisis, additional state financing may not be a viable option at this time. Even if that became an option in the future, I commend that we put in place an explicit public funding of political parties bill in a bipartisan and inclusive manner to regulate this phenomenon. I further recommend that should public funding of political parties be scaled up in the foreseeable future, then an independent and credible institution must be selected to administer the state resources advanced to political parties. In that regard, a sharing formula could be established to ensure fairness, and specific disclosure requirements on beneficiary parties must be imposed. This must be complemented by auditing and publication of party accounts. I accept a lot more needs to be understood regarding how political parties are financed, because these could have implications on our developmental outcomes. We must understand how politicians finance their campaigns for office and to whom they are indebted and are expected to pay back. It is therefore important we engage in a sustained discussion and build consensus on funding political parties within the context of public policy to promote good governance and democratic practice in Ghana. Regarding the needed reforms, the starting point may be Chapter 7 of Ghana's 1992 Constitution, Article 55, and also the Political Parties Act, Act 574, that regulates campaign financing.
I think before the next election, it should become a topical issue, because this public office holders accountability law or bill, which has been outstanding, will have been a very good law to ensure that people are measured when they get to public office. So we must ask each of the aspirants, how long will it take you to pass this law? And if you don't pass this law when you come into office within this period of time, what should happen? Or what should be the consequences for that? I think we may have to have a discussion. If you read the law, it will pain you. It's a very good law. And so they don't like it. And I have colleagues of mine who tell me that, why do you people want us to publish our assets for all our village folks and friends to know? The queue in front of our gate will be very long. They will be asking for... So if you're afraid of doing this, then don't go into the public office. That's the name of the game. If the game says declare your assets, you must declare your assets.
Should they also be asked to not only declare the sources of the amount of money they are coming in with, but tell us how they intend funding their campaigns and whether or not they are committed to telling everybody where they got the money, how they got the money, properly audited and published their reward? Is this something that we should be exacting as commitments from leading candidates?
Exactly. That is exactly the point I'm making. You may have to tell us your key things that you are going to do before coming into office and how you are going to fund it. And even the campaign promises also that you'll be giving us, you must tell us how much is involved, where you get all those monies from, etc., so that we can judge you accordingly. So I think it is right we do that. It is not too late. Fortunately, the next election is some months, almost a year or more than a year away. So we should be able to set the platform to tell people that, well, You say you are going to go door to door. How are you going to fund that door to door? How much does it cost you when you do it the first door to door in maybe one village? And how much do you have? Are you ready to disclose that? When will we get the published audited financial statement of your party or of your activities to be sure that these activities are above board, etc.? I think we should start setting those agendas.
They are very genuine and legitimate, most of financing political parties. But the fact still remains that the manner and source of our funding creates room for corruption. And I have practical experience. We came into power, I was appointed as Minister of Youth and Sports, and I was confronted with JIDA. Now, JIDA was started by the previous government, NPP, it was NYEP. And the way it was started as a pilot program, so there were no proper institutions in place. The systems were not in place, and it was virtually a free-for-all. We came to power, we expanded it, and people took advantage of the weaknesses in the system. So by the time I took office, it was virtually a mess, and the president said, clean it up. So with characteristic zeal, I also started clean up. Hey, that was when my problem started. It wasn't easy. And it was a very awkward, difficult situation, because most of the service provided were people that I knew personally, and there were people that had supported us. And I know they support both sides. And so you have a situation where you have gone to take money from the person to run your campaign, and then you come back and say you are now investigating the person, canceling his contracts, and it was very, very, very difficult. So I started asking myself questions. I mean, what is it that we can do? That, because the average businessman would rather put his 5 million or 10 million back into his business to expand. But we go to them and put pressure on them. We need money. And indeed, we do need money. And then afterwards, when we take the money from them, they are business people, they are not charities. So they have to recoup their money. And when they now do things, and then we now turn back and say we are investigating them, then what are we doing? Are we deceiving ourselves? So for me, you've heard about BOST. An MP was very honest and frank. He said the BOST man cannot be sacked because he contributed heavily to the campaign. These are realities.
Okay, so you just, the last speaker was Elvis Ifri Yankra, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Former youth and sports minister. And in that program where I was there, I mean, he talked about the reality of the situation. The fact that today, a lot of the challenges that you have with corruption are always, most of the time, associated with party financiers. So this morning, we want to get into that conversation. But even before we get into how to finance it and all, we will start on a certain note. We'll start on why it is so expensive today to get into parliament and to become president. Raymond, let's set the tone for the conversation. Before we get onto that, and speak to Dr. Kujo Pumpuni Asante.
So we know that we have to hold elections. Mm-hmm. Let's not forget that in the Republic of Ghana, many, in fact, the position of the literature is that we do electoral democracy. The biggest sign that we are a democracy, the biggest one, is that we hold elections.
Yeah.
And that we hold elections and change governments. So elections are so important to our democracy. Without it, really nothing much really up to, we don't have enough to show for it. Again, there are general tenets like having a level playing field, not abusing incumbency. All of those are elements that promote a better engagement to ensure that the people's voice, true democratic representation, is felt. But how do we do it? We spend so much in elections, and you said it right. Listen, let's nobody pretend to us. Nobody is forcing us to spend the millions that the CDD is referencing on elections. Nobody is forcing us to do so. It's because we have created a system, rent-seeking behavior. The guy takes money from me as delegates, as my mate selling something somewhere, to say that he vote for me, through other means like school fees, like hospital bills, people even going to marry, which is not compulsory, they have to go and take money from their politician. Then when they take the money from the politician, this same gentleman, we're talking about investment by business people, mm-hmm. He's also going to take money from a businessman. He comes to invest in you, then rent-seeking behavior, when he becomes a politician, he will now tell you that I paid you, So I have to make sure that the contract, a certain, what do you call it, percentage of it comes to me. And that's why they are all, you see, all of these people, they go into parliament, they want to be ministers. Mm-hmm. If they become ministers, they're happy. Because that's where they are getting things. In fact, they choose ministries. Some of them, when they get certain ministries, even though they are also ministers at cabinet level, they are not happy.
In fact,
because some of them, you can become minister in this republic and be like, you're not a minister at all.
Well, let me just say this. I mean, one minister told me some time ago that, oh, you know, right now, in the new ministry that I'm in, I don't control any budget.
Can you believe that?
Wow.
Yeah, because...
Yeah, I don't control any budget.
Because essentially, it's about the money they have gotten. And they go and take a lot. You see, some of these people, they get positions merely because of the guy they brought in to bring money. Mm. Almost yeah. like, yeah. yes. So yeah. so he's not special. He's not known for anything. Yeah. He cannot run any ministry properly. In fact, if it is his qualifications alone, he's not supposed to even be in politics.
Okay.
But the gentleman is raising all the money and bringing in the right people. Sometimes money from foreigners. We know the Nigerian experience. I cannot recall in the last almost 20 years which election we've had in this country where big people in Nigeria have not funneled money from other sources. Monies that we cannot properly account for. Monies that we cannot properly source.
That's against our laws.
Oh, we're staying.
Well, hold on 1 minute for me. Let me get onto the phone lines. Because Dr. Kujo Pumpuni Asante, who is Director of Advocacy and Policy Engagement at the Center for Democratic Development, CDD Ghana, has joined us. Dr. Kujo Asante, good morning, and thank you very much for joining us.
Good morning to everybody.
Great. So before we get into even the cost components, your research indicates that you are supposed to send about, 4 million Ghana cedis before you get into parliament?
Yeah, thank you very much, Wesley. Let me just make a preliminary point. I mean, I think for me, why we should be very concerned and try to get solutions to this problem is because, increasingly people are asking themselves, all this process we go through every 4 years, massive injection of resources to try to make sure there's no violence, there's, participation, we go and all stand in line and vote. And when we vote for our elected leaders who, and also those who get appointed, they get into government. And because of corruption, we don't get the benefits that we need. We don't get the dividends of all that, elaborate process that we go through. And we are doing this every 4 years. And I think people are getting...
Hello, Doc. Well, since we've lost Dr. Kujo Asante, we'll try and raise him back on the line. He started by talking about, how it's become very expensive. Every 4 years we go through this process. Mm. But the key question is, why is it so expensive?
Because the people, it's almost like an illegal trade. The stakes are upped every time because the participants want to get more results from it. If I'm a business person and inflation has taken all my money, and this time I'm pumping some money into your thing, I want better results. What results would I want? I want 4 times, 5 times my money. So it becomes more expensive because people want to also spend more, influence people more, Ghanaians, pay from the woman selling by the street to the delegate. And delegate, it depends on who you are and at what level you are, the amount of money some of them receive. And pay the middlemen, the people who arrange these financial engagements. So some of the candidates, they may never see the guy who brought the money. Okay. The middleman takes it and takes a percentage of it. Now he is taking his own cut. He edits the money. Mm. Then before he presents the final money to the main man.
Let's get back onto the phone line. It says, Dr. Asante, you're making a point. Please continue.
Yeah, one thing. So increasingly, we actually risk the democracy that, we have. Remember, we are 30 years of the Fourth Republic.
Yeah.
We really risk it because increasingly, the people who come into government, because they need to recoup their investment, and of course some of them are very, very greedy and they want to amass all kinds of wealth, we don't get, even in terms of policy, the policies are not coherent, we don't get the development dividends that we're supposed to get, and people are asking themselves, why should we keep going and doing this? So it's a very, we are running out of time if we don't correct these problems. And the big One of the really bad drivers of this kind of phenomenon is campaign financing. Oh. And as you said, we started doing these studies in 2017, where we looked at parliamentarians. Even at that time, the escalating cost between 2012 to 2016 was like 60%. Oh. So it cost more, in almost 60% more in 2016 than it was in 2012 for MPs. And then even at that time was like $85,000 for an MP to stand for election. And if you take an MP salary at that time, it will be about, you know, 2 years of your salary, you know, to put that together.
Oh.
You know, and then, you know, when we did it in 2021, it was 4 million, you know, Ghana cedis, because increasingly this idea that you have to now nurture your constituency.
Mm-hmm.
If you intend to stand in the constituency, you have to start doing development projects. You are taking care of all kinds of things for people for almost 2 years, 3 years before you even start to contest. So all the people, for example, in the NDC who are contesting now would have been doing, spending all kinds of monies from 2021 to this point before they even get to the primaries. And then when they get to the primaries and they succeed, then you continue spending to the public election. So these things are not sustainable. You know, how do you raise $4 million? And these are even conservative estimates. And okay, given the current inflationary pressures that we have, it means it's going to even cost more, because items will cost more. You know, all those services will cost more. You know, and then if you take the presidential elections, that's $100 million, you know, minimum, that you are talking about.
$100 million minimum.
Yes, because if
we're to convert it today, we're looking at over Mr. 1 Mahab, billion Ghana cedis.
He was making, Professor Kwame Nahor, he was making the point that if every constituency is getting a pickup, you know, for the, not for just election, you know, efforts, and not just even before that, but just elections, every constituency is getting a pickup. And then you need some for regional, you need some for national, that alone. And then, you know, training polling agents for, you know, two times before election.
Oh.
That alone was close to 500 million Ghana cedis. So that's just, we haven't talked about adverts. We haven't talked about all of the things. But the question that we have to ask ourselves is that, do we need to spend all these things?
Exactly.
Because when you start thinking about it, you know, in other places where you cut the cost down, there are spending limits, because you are spending more because your opponent is also spending more. And if your opponent is an incumbent, then it means that he's even going to spend more of the taxpayers' money to try to match you in elections.
Hmm.
So we are, I mean, some of the costs is excessive. It doesn't, you know, as you are saying, all these things, the vote buying that, you know, people do all the time. We have to find a way to discipline the spending so that we can, you know, reduce the cost. And then contributing might not be, you know, such a big problem.
So let's look at how we
billboards.
Yeah, so
need the size of the billboards that people are putting up, for instance.
Okay. Now, let's look at the cost now. Now, the first point would be even the party's own guidelines and rules. Because the party says before you qualify, you should have nurtured the constituency.
I.e. done projects.
Done projects. So that's where the first problem starts from.
Yes.
So do we have to then engage the parties on removing these blocks that sometimes lead to increased expenditure on elections?
Yes, there are two steps. First, at the moment, we don't have any regulations for internal party, you know, spending provisions and so on and so forth. You see, you have to standardize, because it's fair, it's competition. If one person is doing it, the other person is not doing it, it's not going to work.
Okay.
So in many places, every single expenditure is basically capped, right? Mm-hmm. And it's a law. It's not MPP constitution or NDC constitution. So that you do something differently and that person does something differently. So that's where we have to get to. what we are talking with campaign financing reform, there has been regulation on internal party, you know, expenditure and donations, right? But in the meantime, there are many things that, as you said, the parties can do in terms of setting, you know, setting limits for expenditure. And if they set the limits, it has to be enforced. But what has happened is that the culture that's built is that because the parties are relying so much on all kinds of financiers, the party managers are not able to enforce the rules. It's the people who are paying the money that basically determine what goes on. So if you don't respect the rules, it's very difficult for you to be disciplined if some big shot is backing you, you know, within the party. It's making the party management and the managers lose the power, the discipline power that they have as executives. And that's happening in most places because they get, you know, just a few people who come in and they are sponsoring everybody's parliamentary or, you know, campaign or presidential campaign. So there's something can be done internally by the parties and try, and there has to be an enforcement to make sure that if you don't follow the rules, then you are disqualified. But that incentive and the ability, the capacity to do that is being diminished because of the culture that we have built currently. So for me, legislation at the end is what has to cure it, so that it becomes by law. It would affect your candidacy if you know you don't comply with the rules.
You know, but yes, you've raised the issue of legislation and all, but one other point also is that you probably would hear politicians talking about the fact that, oh, there needs to be, I mean, there need to be a contest so you galvanize the base. And yes, that's how you motivate, you know, the grassroots. So they're always looking forward to this. I mean, around this time, you have lots of, you know, delegates calling people and saying, oh, won't you contest? Have you picked a form? How do we even deal with these delegates?
Yeah, so for me, the delegate system is a problem. It's one, and it's one of the things that legislation should change. Because, of course, the fewer the people, as you said, you have more suitors, right? And then it becomes the highest bidder. We've seen this in Nigeria in very obscene ways, where, you know, the kinds of money people are just giving. So the delegate system really, should disappear. You know, you have to, you know, go expand it like the NDC has done it, basically to allow constituencies, you know, to basically vote, you know, for all these candidates. And the voting systems really should not be that expensive. Now you are busing people, you know, to move from this place. They can be in their constituencies and do the voting. And that will also limit, you know, the opportunity to just spend money for delegates, because we know it's a corrupted system. But it has to be by law so that it's not done differently by NDC or done differently by MPP or PNC or somebody else.
Okay.
So the key to really regulating internal party primaries and all of those steps is really state legislation, because that's, you know, that's really the only way in which you set the same rules for everybody to comply with.
Let me bring in Dr. Emmanuel Akwetey, who is Executive Director for the Institute of Democratic Governance, IDEG. Doc, good morning, and thank you very much for joining us.
Good morning.
Great. So we're having the conversation. We started with how to reduce, you know, the cost of the elections itself. We'll get to the financing point, but first of all, how do we reduce the cost? Because $4 million for those wanting to go to Parliament, $100 million for a party that wants to win the presidential election, clearly, it's a lot of money. What must be done to reduce the cost of running elections in Ghana?
Well, first of all, we have to take a medium-term view. You can't do it immediately because next year is election.
Sure.
And the economy, the state of the economy is there. But, you know, the election costs are high because we've not rationalized the campaign process arena. And the state, look, parties cannot just operate as private entities. The sole purpose of a party, it should gain access to state power and become an agent of the state. And the state is resource. The state, nobody is as rich as the state if we manage its resources well. And so civil society people cannot contest elections as civil society organizations. So my brother, Pujo Asante, if he wants to contest election, has to resign from CDD and go and be a party person. And if he wants, he's then elected and he goes into parliament, he's now in the state arena and an agent of the state in a way. So you don't go, it's not about profit business, it's about how you're going to now serve the people, because that is where it takes place. So if we approach it that way, a lot of the parties really haven't set themselves up as parties that within their membership have a lot of money. And yesterday I was talking about, just look at dues. But I think the problem is the state has to look at how to structure this framework of financing and the obligations. Look, we're a civil society. They tell us that if we sell books or we do events that brings money, we should take out our costs. The rest is not for us as private individuals who are going to share it, okay? And say, oh, Miniska, no. They ask you to declare it, and you may pay taxes on them. You have to register with GRA and pay taxes. Unless you tell GRA that you're going to plow this money back into business, and they need evidence of that.
Sure.
So, and parties are not far from CSOs. They are not business entities, because the business of the state is not one for profit. The state will make profit, but it will put it into all sorts of uses and plow it back. So once they commit themselves that they want to be agents of the state, there must be adequate rules to govern them, and there are none, or not many, that are enforced. So in this case, if you're going to look at elections, there are many things they do in elections that they shouldn't do. What is this treating? You know, treating is against the regulations of elections.
Sure.
The Electoral Commission has a compendium. It's as thick as what? And it has all those rules and regulations. They don't enforce them. And the parties know, but they also disregard them. Mm. So you've heard about how delegates who go to congresses to choose leaders and so on are told how they are bribed and how many buy cars from it and even start their own business. So the place is anarchy. It's unregulated. It's a free market. Survival of the fittest. And that is what is playing. And then when they get into government, we have problems. They borrowed. There are no even records of them. But the business of the party, because it wants to stay, must be open to public interest. And there has to be a state agency that looks at this. Read all the literature on parties in Europe, and you see how rigid the system is. You make money, you would invest, you declare them, you plow them back. But you don't pocket them as your profit. So there's a contradiction between how our parties are operating now, and especially conferences to elect people and delegates and so on. Too much bribery. Too much private business driving it. But it has to be controlled, and it has to be regulated. At the moment, I think for 23 people, the minimum is going to be agreed. I don't think it will happen. But thereafter, this is what I think. The parties ought to be able to generate revenue from their membership, but it doesn't belong to private business. It's for them. Mm. They can invest, but they must declare and must be plowed back to business, party business. This is the non-profit nature of parties and civil society and so on. Okay. And even when they invest, the money must come back, and they should declare. So that is the first thing. But to curtail it, what is this huge banners, billboards? You have to declare what it cost and where you got the money. And why are there many, and why do they stay for so long? If you mount a billboard or any party campaign billboard anywhere, even just, I don't know what comes before billboard. Billboard is big. But those posters, they do, and so on and so forth. In some countries, As soon as the election, most of Europe, as soon as the elections end, the results are declared, the next morning you won't see them. The local authorities will pull all of them out.
Yeah.
And they say they do that because to signal that they've entered a new phase of governance. Mm. The competition is over. Now they must solve the problems and so on. Here, they do billboards standing anywhere. There is no accountability of candidates to anybody on where they get their money. And so it opens the doors to people who should never, ever put money in parties. They borrow heavily from them, and then they start chasing them.
Okay.
Parliament is a place where they said, if you are bankrupt, you can't be a member of parliament. We don't have a system to assess whether our MPs or the candidates are in good standing,
okay.
Not only in the payment of their taxes, but in their business generally, because the public interest is served not in a money-making place. You could invest, but you have to declare everything. So to cut things down, maybe the minimum of the regulations that can be imposed now, I'm not sure if the Electoral Commission is in a situation or another state entity to say you can't use billboards. And you have to account fully for the cost of those. Who will enforce that now? I don't know.
Okay.
And they don't account. They are not accountable. Government business is accountability.
Sure.
So I think the framework we've created, the structures we've put in place, are quasi. I mean, we let them. It's so anarchic, and it's a little bit, it's like a game, a play. It's not serious. So we need to at least start with these expenditures too. The treating is a big rally. Okay. Huge. It's fine, American in a way. But in Europe, you're not seeing those anymore or often as you do. Because to reduce campaign costs, they've now decided that, there are little ways you can start campaign.
Well, I guess we can get straight back into our conversation on the phones. Dr. Kojo Pumpuni Asante, Director of Advocacy and Policy Engagement at the Center for Democratic Development, CDD Ghana. Dr. Emmanuel Akwetey is Executive Director of the Institute for Democratic Governance, IDEG. Now, we've heard from both of them the realities of the stumbling blocks in our way when it comes to sanitizing the space for political party financing. So now let's try and figure out what the solution ought to look like. And I'll start with you, Dr. Asante. So clearly the first step is we need that far more robust and much better law so that there is something to compel political parties to clean up how they raise funds. The question I have is this. In order for that law to come into being, it must be passed by the people who benefit the most from the status quo. We've seen it happen in the past with things like the right to information law, which took decades to pass through parliament. Can we realistically expect the people whose livelihoods will be most affected by a more robust campaign financing law to actually let that law pass?
Yeah, thank you very much. No, I actually have a lot more confidence in us moving forward to develop, some regulation around this, because actually all the noises that are coming out, yes, for civil society, we've always pushed for campaign financing reform, but increasingly, the party managers themselves are beginning to see the danger, because it is completely disrupting the whole idea of party formation and development, and Dr. Akwetey has alluded, to what the role of a party is in a democracy, and it is completely not it as we currently have. So the working group, for example, we've been working on since last year, since the study came out in 2021, have people like Mr. McMenu on there, Alhaji Nusa Fuseni, Honorable Susu, Madam Bridget Dobonyuku, and even your own advancement is on there. The multi-stakeholder group that has been working towards a roadmap, and we recognize that it is something that because you have an impending election, it's very difficult to set the rules and enforce it before. this 2024 election. But there's an appetite for, you know, developing, you know, the scope of all the things that we need to make sure that we can move to that level. And in the short term, there's even some ideas that have already been put, you know, together. And I think that for me, they are very feasible. So, for example, in Ghana, we don't have a campaign period, a set campaign period by law. In Nigeria, they have. In many other places in West Africa and Africa, there is a campaign period. So formal campaign starts at a certain time. And when you do that, it reduces the time frame within which you can actually spend money or spend resources on a campaign, you know, and we need to be able to fix that. So between when you become officially a candidate, right, not an aspirant, so when you go through nomination to the time when you, you know, elections start, there's a period there that you can set as a campaign period, whether it's a 3 months or a 6 month period or whatever, but you can agree on a campaign period. And within that campaign period, you can set things that can happen or should happen and should can be regulated. So we think that is very much feasible. We think that the Electoral Commission, in terms of its filing, its fees that it sets for elections, nomination processes and so on, you know, can be reduced. We think we can do something about vote by working with the special prosecutor and other agencies. You know, we've seen some of that in Nigeria recently, and I think it was effective. So there are short-term things that we can do, even as we develop the regulations, because one of the things we need to appreciate is that, yes, there's a cost to elections, and what are the more legitimate costs, and the cost that really just is just coming out of, you know, excessive competition that really does not need to happen. Once we can itemize those things, there are things you can put a cap on. You know, posters. If you go to Kenya, you hardly see people putting posters all around the place. You know how we completely deface our city when elections come. In many African countries, you will not see that. There are billboards, but even the billboards, you don't have to have the huge billboards that, you know, and how many can you do? These things are easy to observe and to regulate. So we think that in the short term, between now and 2024, at the minimum, let's set a campaign period, a formal campaign period, where we can regulate certain things. And then we continue to work on a more elaborate program. But I, as you said, often, yes, you get some resistance and so on, and it drags. But I said, I think there's an appetite for this because everybody's seeing the danger and the threat to the democracy itself, and you know, politicians have been the biggest beneficiary of the false Republican democracy. So, if they want it to collapse, then basically it's all their futures that is going to go up in smoke. So, I think there's an incentive for everybody to make this work, and so far, at least in what I've seen, there's the real genuineness. People want to see something happen. So we should take advantage of that and get that process going.
Great.
I'll just add one thing, you know, which just to give you a flavor of how some of these discussions have gone. That, for example, everybody knows that, you know, in elections, when during campaigns, you have to visit every funeral, you know, there's almost every church, every week, you know, and they'll tell you how much they're spending on those things. Even that, you have to cap it, right? Mm-hmm. They have to say, you can only give a donation at a funeral of 100 cedis or 200 cedis, mm-hmm. and applies to everybody. Because it becomes a competition. Oh, this person went to give 5,000, so we are going to give. And if you're doing that every week, this is an unnecessary cost. And society should not be putting that kind of pressure, because then it adds to the corruption. So there are cultural things that you have to manage, but there's a sensible way of managing that, if as long as it's across board.
Great. Let me bring in Dr. Akwetey. And there's been this conversation about the state coming in to assist. We've talked about state funding of political parties. You know, many of the times when parties are in opposition, they support it. When they get into government, then they forget about it. How will the state's financing of political parties help solve this problem? Hello, Dr. Akwetey. Yes.
Please volume up a bit. Most of it, I'm straining my ears.
Okay, so I was just asking, for instance, that there's been lots of conversations about, you know, the state funding political parties, and I'm asking, how will that help solve this problem?
If it's the problem of the elections and the state funding, you know, the state used to have limited inputs where sometimes it's not always money, but where it came money, it was initially they gave them some big vehicles, you know, and then pickups or whatever, and then they had this public address system. And so I didn't know if in this you know, AI period, those things are what they should give. But in reality, in the rural communities, maybe because we're dealing with technology at its highest, and so on and so forth. So state funding could be where really there are no cheaper ways of doing things, and they can facilitate that. Where we are now, I think the state takes time to make decisions. Its decisions are backed by policy, approved. Sometimes they would even enact a law before that happens. So a lot depends on preparing the ground for that to happen in the future. I do not think between now and next year, December, and given the financial situation of the country and so on, the state would even be interested. Okay, because so we might have to live with the situation we are facing. Even limiting the period for elections takes a lot of consultations. The state's relations with parties has its own processes of consultation, consensus building, in spite of the fact that the EC is independent and can make any decision. But when you are in a context where you have two giants of parties and extremely weak parties outside the arena, you could know why it is important to consult the state, consult the parties on some of the decisions you want to make. It's just like, you know, you couldn't, the EC could just get up and say, well, we now must do elections. The campaign period will be from October or from September to November or December. And that is a whole lot of things, because parties will come to the table and say, well, this should have been announced later. We planned this way. Why do you want, and they could go to court and so on. You remember when the EC attempted to exclude certain parties from the 2016 election?
Sure.
Yeah, Park Sindom's party, and they went to court, and the court said, hey, the EC cannot do that. So there are processes that of engagement, of consultation, of taking their views, like a decision-making process and so on, that must start. For now, I think the problem the EC has to make some good decisions is the impact with NDC. You know, having a duopolistic system changes everything. If our parties were a bit even, you know, and so on, it makes the EC stronger. And they can come to the table. You don't attend, others would attend, and so on. But you have only two parties. And in the situation where NDC is boycotting EC IPAC meetings, and it wants a certain settlement, you know, an approach that you say to discuss, it wants the reform of IPAC and all that, and time is running out, you are likely to see the EC struggling, because it makes a decision and it looks like the only party on the table out of the two will be MPP. And that has a whole lot of interpretations, whether it's right or wrong. So it's in the EC is, is, I think the best way we would advocate is the EC should, as soon as possible, resolve the impasse with over, I wouldn't say even impasse with NDC. When you listen to the NDC, it's not just the NDC picking things up, but what you're dealing with is the state of IPAC since 20-something years after it was put in place. Okay, and how small parties, how decisions are made and what they want to see changed and all that. And I think that this issue affects MPP. When parties are in government, they tend to be friends of the EC for all sorts of wrong reasons or correct reasons, you know. And then when they go into opposition, what we're seeing with MPP, NDC today with the EC, we might likely see also with an MPP in opposition and the EC. Okay. But the fundamental thing is that that conflict must be resolved. When it's resolved, they can come to some agreement on measures that the EC wants, some interventions that it wants to make, listening to the public, and streamlining quite a lot of the things that will go into the campaign. Okay? It can be done, but the approach has always been consultations and consensus. And if we had more parties in, that could go into IPAC, that would have been a different situation.
But Doc, we have more parties going to IPAC, actually.
No, but that's part of the conflict of the EC. They are not parliamentary parties, because only the two parties is a hung parliament. Most of the parties, they claim, well, the EC has done well to, you know, remove some out of it, but there are so many. And they're even making serious allegations about how those little parties who come all, I'm sorry, they might take me on, but the parties out of parliament, how they are enticed to make decisions and to support the, you see, they are very serious allegations. And until we resolve that quickly, the situation we have is going to be difficult. We have been talking to the MPP. We started when they had Mr. Fred Blair as the chair. We are exploring ways of talking to the current chairman, the NIM, and the general secretary, and about a proposal that would say, please resolve this impasse. Take an interest in it, because what we see is they alternate even on conflict. When they are in government, they deal with EC differently. When they get out, they deal with EC differently. EC is the only authority we have on this. Okay. And in that polarized situation, conflict ought to be resolved. Because any attempt by EC to say, well, you can go to hell if you don't want, I'm going ahead. You know, duopolies. Look, they can mobilize. It will create a whole lot of situations for us, which is not good at this time, given the security threats, given the economic challenges we're facing, and the anxiety in town. I mean, people are feeling the heat of the economy and so on and so forth. So I'd like to see some of these things. The best we can do now is to quickly resolve the conflict with between NDC over the IPAC and the EC, and let MPP get involved. They should resolve it quickly to free that space the EC should have to deal with everybody as impartially as it would do or it can do, without this perception that it is on one side or it's being directed. I think it must be resolved very quickly. Once that is done, I hope this will be the last election that we can see a whole lot of the things that are happening. Okay, that happened, that makes us question what the parties are for and so on. And like Kujo said, we believe strongly that we must have election seasons, and we must have time for parties to do development work.
Okay.
So many years ago, we proposed that the EC is so confined to elections that anything beyond the election border becomes for somebody else to take up. And therefore, we talked about the multi-party democracy commission, which would do make sure that the electoral cycle, okay, is regulated. Now you can do elections anytime, but that electoral cycle should. But the work of, and it's an advocacy that even His Majesty Otumfuo has made several times, that look at this thing and let's have time where it's election and time for development. And once we are able to get some of these reforms through, you begin to see that even the all these huge billboards that come in, the feeding, the bribing, the giving people money and so on, are all going to look at by an entity that says, what are you doing? Is it within the law? Is it against the law? Can you come every August, beginning from July to September, tell us about your policies, your manifestos? What research have you done? What new policies are you coming with? So where in the party secretariat do you have the capacity to do this?
Okay.
Those are matters of interest not only to parties, but it should be of interest to the state.
Mm.
That's how state funding comes in. The state is not going to give them money for elections, apart from the public address systems and so on it gave, and access to radio. Even access to radio has changed now because the state is not controlling all radio stations, except GBC. So with time, what we're going to see is that a state entity will now get the parties to change their business post-election and say that you can't do elections over the 4 years. Can we have a season for when all this thing, it will cut down costs? But can you also tell us about the policies, the manifesto you presented, even if you lost elections, they are relevant things for solving the problems, health, education, employment, housing, whatever, growth, and so on and so forth. It must be the business of the state.
Okay.
What is the state that authority? What gives the state that authority is that it is only parties that present, are allowed and recognized to present themselves to do state business. They are agents. They are not the state. So the state has its rules. And therefore, what the state will do would be it is going to invest in the capacities that would allow the parties to do the state business, whether they are in opposition or in government. That is where funding comes in.
Okay.
It will stick to regulate through EC how they spend on elections, treating, and so on. It might cut it down and say, we don't accept this anymore. But for the moment, there is this thing that the party is the state and government once it is elected. But it is not the case. Even in Europe, they have campaign season.
Okay. Let's get back to it. And Dr. Kojo Asante and Dr. Emmanuel Akwetey on the line. And just before the break, we were seeking to engage Dr. Kojo Asante on the role of the state going forward in resolving this issue of party financing, whether state financing is the solution. Dr. Asante, your thoughts on this?
Yeah. So just a quick point on the financing part. All the Afro-Rometer surveys clearly shows that there's a very little appetite, at least among the population, for state funding of parties. But I think it needs to be considered seriously. I think some good ideas about funding in kind. There's already the Electoral Commission always plays the role in internal party primaries as the official electoral commission. Most of the time the parties have to pay for it. So you can, once you're paying for the electoral commission and its staff and so on, there are ways in which that service could be absorbed by the state. And it's still a huge component of party organization. So there are ways in which the cost of funding, legitimate cost, that is, funding parties and the activities, can be supported by the state. And I think that's one of the ways that we can look, if we can even do actual, sort of direct funding of parties, I think we can start with those kinds of things. So there are ways to develop this, and as you said, it's just the political will. I feel there is something there that we can work with, but we need to work fast because people are losing trust in the current system. It's not delivering for us, and if we don't change it, people get even more frustrated, and I don't want to think about the consequences of that. So we will continue to work, and former President Mahama also raising that issue, and I expect other candidates and the parties themselves to begin to look at this issue so we can get a solution to it.
Well, I think that's a great point to end our conversation on. I want to say a very big thank you to our two guests. Dr. Kujo Pumpuni Asante is the Director of Advocacy and Policy Engagement at the Center for Democratic Development, CDD Ghana. Dr. Emmanuel Akwetey, Executive Director of the Institute for Democratic Governance, IDEG. Thank you both very much for your time. Ray, what's the... what's the thought on the on these interesting views shared?
Yeah, they're very wonderful ones. And let's be quite clear on this particular matter. It's not for the lack of alternatives or an understanding of what we have to deal with and where we have to go from here. It's a lack of commitment from the major players in the area. It's almost like taking food out of the mouth of the people. And we are struggling, and I suspect we will struggle more to get them to commit. If they are unable to pass or unwilling to pass or support the passage of that public officers bill, the new one, you can be rest assured they will not be willing to pass any bill that does more regulation, of because there are no disclosure laws, as we all know it to be, in our current political party financing or campaign financing rules as we have it today. So it's a bit very vague. It's almost like how secret engagements do happen. Again, there are no limits, and those limits are absolutely important. The limits are absolutely crucial because we want to create some semblance of a level playing field. If we allow it, and knowing how crucial Ghana is, you could see players, based on even ideology and other things, funneling money from so many quarters. We struggle to even follow and control illicit flow of funds. But if it is, we're having the backing of political party, which invariably will mean that we have the backing of government, there's no way we can put a cap on it. If we do not take care the way we are going, it's not impossible, or might not be impossible in the nearest future, to have drug barons. You think about it. People with very dangerous thoughts, terrorists, funding political parties in this country, and will still be playing the proverbial ostrich and pretending nothing's going wrong.
Okay, so we asked a few questions on Twitter. Yeah. We're asking all of you whether you thought that, you know, the public funding of political parties would improve the quality of governance and reduce corruption. And at Papi Solo says, of course, it won't just prevent people from purchasing votes to win elections. It will also enable honorable candidates who lack the funding to do so to run for office. Political parties must not accept any funding aside party dues. Then at Sape says, it would definitely reduce the barriers to participation and encourage many new parties to emerge. Politicians need to become less self-serving and more patriotic. At Masawudu says, it is the right way to go. And Nii Mbubuashi says, Ghana cannot sponsor these current politicians of ours. And to deal with the corruption which the current system of political party financing, our various arms of government need to be really made independent. To be able to arrest the corruption in this country, we need a new constitution, you add. Richard Inteshi says, I think political parties should establish their own multi-farms and subsequently factories that add value to their products. These investments will bring in so much funds to the parties if well managed. Stay with us. When we return after these messages, I probably will share my own thoughts with you. We'll be right back.